Good evening, fans, and welcome to tonight's pregame show for our contest between the Leuzinger Olympians, who've made the short trip over to Helcap Field to take on their arch rival and nemesis, the Hawthorne Cougars, in the annual Mayor's Cup. I'm Rufus Washington, joined as always by Dave Marks. Dave, this is going to be a game that has major playoff implications for Hawthorne. Leuzinger in control of their destiny, but Hawthorne needing a win tonight to stay alive.
Yes, Rufus, in a couple of games that I've done here, the battle for the Mayor's Cup, this one is not just a symbolic battle. This one is a battle for survival here because, quite frankly, the home team here tonight, Hawthorne, has to win. If Hawthorne loses and Beverly Hills wins and Redondo wins, Hawthorne is eliminated. If Leuzinger wins this ball game here tonight, they're guaranteed of at least a playoff spot. They won't get first. They are not guaranteed second, but they at least will be in the playoffs. So the season for Hawthorne is on the line, and a lot is at stake tonight for Leuzinger. So this is perhaps, of all the games that we've done between these two schools, the most significant.
Certainly is. And to add to it, let's go down field side to Brian Goodman, I believe. And Brian's going to be ready with some pregame stats. Or do we have Deborah? Let's go to Deborah Savage. Deborah Savage has the mayors with her, Mayor Larry Guidi of Hawthorne and Mayor Harold Hofmann of Lawndale. As we said, this is the Mayor's Cup 2001. Deborah, take it away.
Annual Mayor's Cup, and I'm here with Mayor Hofmann and Mayor Guidi. Mayor Hofmann, what will your team do tonight to win the trophy?
Well, we're going to play a good game, and I think both teams are going to play good games. And we're going to play our hardest, and I just told the mayor that we almost didn't bring the trophy because we figured we were going to take it back.
Okay, Mayor Guidi, now what do you think your team will do to win the game tonight and to take home the trophy?
Well, I heard Harold polished it all day so he could hand it to me nice and shiny tonight because I felt bad for him. I let him have it for a couple years. Now it's coming home tonight.
Thank you, gentlemen.
You're welcome.
All right, great work by Deborah there, and you hear both mayors representing their respective teams have a strategy in place they believe that will lead them to victory tonight, or at least lead the teams that they support to victory day.
Well, you have a situation with two schools where you know pretty much what they want to do. You're looking at the Hawthorne side of the field there, the home crowd here tonight at Hawthorne. What the Leuzinger Olympians, of course, want to do, and we'll get to that point about some strategy, but first, I think we are going to go to Scott, who's standing down on the field, and he's going to talk to us about some of those statistics. So if Scott, yeah. If you are ready, let's take it away, Scott.
Well, as Scott continues to get in position, and we can notice that from here, the one thing about tonight's game obviously featured a running game. Both teams have a powerful running attack. Billy Mitchell on the Hawthorne side, and of course, Leuzinger's backfield has been well talked about. If anything, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, at least Hawthorne has a bit of a passing game. But Scott's ready, so let's go down field side to Scott Goodman for some pregame stats.
We are here at Helcap Field, where today we have the big game of the year between the Hawthorne Cougars and the Leuzinger Olympians. Both teams are fighting for their playoff lights, as Hawthorne is coming with a 3-5 record and a 2-3 record in league. Leuzinger's coming in 4-3-1 overall with a 3-2 record in league. Last year, the Olympians were victorious 35-20 against the Cougars, so the Cougars are looking for some redemption. Last week, the Olympians came out with a 22-0 shutout over the Peninsula Panthers, big win for them. And Hawthorne had a very tough loss, losing 21-20 to Redondo Beach. In order to go home with a victory for Leuzinger, they must contain mobile Hawthorne quarterback Courtney Barden. And on the other side of the ball, Hawthorne's big, bruising defensive line must contain Leuzinger's bruising, running, run-orientated wing, double-wing tee offense. Look forward to the game. It should be a bruising game. Should be close. and the ground game, whoever comes out with the best ground game should win. Thank you so much. Up to Rufus and Dave.
Thank you, Scott, for an outstanding report. Scott certainly gave fans a very good perspective of what they can expect tonight. And I tell you, fans, stay right where you are, because in just a moment we're going to have the opening kickoff. But this concludes for tonight our pregame show. Hope you enjoyed it, and we'll see you again next week. But in just a few moments, we've got a contest between the Leuzinger Olympians visiting here at Helcap Field as they take on the Hawthorne Cougars in the 2001 Mayor's Cup. Good evening, fans, and welcome to tonight's contest on Channel 22 Sports in Lawndale. I'm Rufus Washington along with Dave Marks, and we are approaching the coin toss here at Helcap Field as the Leuzinger Olympians have made the short trip to take on their arch rival, the Hawthorne Cougars, in what promises to be an exciting game. Right now, let's go down field side for the coin toss. There you see Mayor Harold Hofmann decked it out in red, white, and blue. That's Mayor Guidi to the right there in the Cougar colors in the burgundy jacket. Mayor Guidi toss it and make the call, and it looks like from the point that Hawthorne has won the toss.
If I were Mayor Hofmann, I'd want to inspect that coin.
So as they line up, Hawthorne has elected to allow Leuzinger to receive. That means they'll get the kickoff to start the second half. Leuzinger in this half will be moving. Let me get my orientation right here.
We're facing west, actually, from where we are. Your cameras are facing west. Those lights you see in the background are cars on the 405 heading north.
All right. So. So this is going to be a north-south movement. I'm thoroughly lost sitting right here in the booth now, Dave.
Well, it's actually, for our point of view, better kind of to be in here tonight. Of all the games that we've done this year, the coolest weather, this true football weather, not cold, but for Southern California, a little nippy tonight as you take a look at Coach Whitt for the Leuzinger Olympians will be in the visiting white tonight, occupying the far side of the field. And they're coming in here tonight with certainly a job to do, although their situation not as desperate as that of the Hawthorne Cougars, who have to win. And we'll be making that point throughout the night. They've got to win in order to stay alive, or else hope that both Beverly Hills and Redondo also lose. So a lot at stake here tonight.
You see a shot of the color guard there on your screen as we prepare for the national anthem. Thank you. All right, fans, there you have it. The Hawthorne Cougar Band with a stirring rendition of the national anthem. And I can tell you, Dave, I think one of the things that have been most notable to me since the tragic events of September 11th have been the renditions of our national anthem and other anthems that we have. And I must admit, speaking of baseball in game two of the Diamondbacks and Yankees series, Ray Charles did a very, very stirring, his own, of course, his own rendition of America the Beautiful, is it?
Well, that only, as you think of America the Beautiful, keep in mind Ray Charles literally changed music with that song, What Did I Say, in 1959. Without Ray Charles, you basically have, he makes the transition from what is called R&B to soul. And without Ray Charles, you don't have that. I mean, so many people in rock were influenced by that song, with the guitar riffs and the piano and everything there. So Ray Charles, most definitely a musical genius.
Yeah. Well, folks, we've got a game to play, and the team's getting ready to take the field. There you see the Leuzinger Olympians clad in the blue pants with the white jersey top. Cougars, of course, when they play at home, they prefer to wear their gold pants with the burgundy top, or cardinal, we should say. Cardinal and gold. Very much resembling SC, as we've told you many times. Of course, everybody around here knows that. But right now, the suspense is just about over. It's time to get it on, as Mills Lane would say.
And for as much as the Torrance Daily Breeze rates football games throughout the week, guess which game they have is number one on the slate to watch this week? Well, you're checking it out right here and now.
Brought to you, as always, by Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22, Hawthorne Community Cable, and our good friends at Time Warner Communications. Fans, we've got a football game right now. Short kickoff, going to be taken at about the 8-yard line by the Olympians. They get it out to the 25-yard line, where it'll be first and 10 for the Olympians as they go on offense first here tonight.
Singleton, of course, on the carry there. He's going to be one of the featured backs. Taking a look at the Leuzinger Olympians offense tonight. On the starting offensive line, Miguel Peralta will be at center. Joe Guerin will be at left guard. Finise Lolela will be left tackle. Right tackle, Tony Morgan. Hiva Hakofa at right tackle. And one of the tight ends will be Maha Ikahifu as Eddie Hernandez starts at quarterback.
Here the first pitch is to Victor McClendon, number four. McClendon picks up good yardage on the play as he moves out across the 30 to about the 33.
Take a look at the rest of the starters who are losing Olympians. The other tight end will be Daniel Navas, a junior. Paul Sakona, Steve Singleton, and Victor McClendon make up the wing tee as they just bring it right on to you.
And last week, as we saw, Brandon Ford got a few carries. Again, keeping it on the ground. This McClendon with the carry picks up the first down. So far, losing them, not coming with any surprises, Dave. I mean, they do what everyone knows them to do, and that's to keep the ball on the ground.
Yeah, they usually don't make the mistakes, and they dare you to stop them. On defense tonight, starting for the Hawthorne Cougars, they have a 4-3 defense. On the defensive line, Luke Lamperti, that's a right defensive tackle. Lefty defensive tackle, Dwayne Smith. Pete Naha, left defensive end, and Chris Feapea, right defensive end.
This time it gets stacked up in the backfield. It's going to be a loss on the play. Cougar defense stiffening to the challenge a bit.
And on the linebacker core for Hawthorne, Chris Peapea, because they used to run a 3-4. He's now up on the line, up on the line tonight. Momo Viomuango will be the middle linebacker. Quick side linebacker, Bo Cajo, and the soft side linebacker, Billy Mitchell. And the defensive backfield, Marcus Washington at cornerback, along with Elgin Simmons, Toe Mawala, and Brian Goodall of the defensive back safety.
Loss of a yard on the play. They come back with another running play. That's Singleton with the carry. Singleton, a senior, also doubles on the defense as a defensive end for this team as well.
And this week, in talking to the people at Leuzinger, they're looking at it as another workmanlike performance. They know what's at stake. They know what they've got to do. And sort of like bring the lunch pail and come to work and just grind it out.
Again, inside handoff. That's McClendon with the carry. McClendon picks up the first down as he moves the ball into Cougar territory, down to the Cougar 47-yard line, where it's going to be a first and 10 for the Olympians here early first quarter action.
They're moving back a rather big defensive line. You got Lamperti, 305 pounds. Dwayne Smith, 250 pounds there on that line. Especially a Pete Naha, who is perhaps a Hawthorne Cougars' best defensive lineman.
McClendon again with the carry. This time they string it out as it comes toward the Cougars' sideline. Short gain on the play, perhaps a half yard.
It seems like they run better, Leuzinger does, when they just take it straight up the middle as opposed to trying to get to the outside. When you see Hawthorne on the offense, I'd say you're going to see probably just the opposite of that approach. They seem to run a lot better wide. These teams last week, Leuzinger winning their ball game, pitching a shutout against Peninsula, a game that we did. And we mentioned Hawthorne lost a heartbreaker by 1 point to Redondo after they were up 20-7. Lost 21-20.
Singleton comes in motion. He gets the pitch back and stumbles forward for about 3 yards on the play. It's going to make it a third and about five for the Olympians.
And now this is going to put them in one of those situations that they, well, you say for your average team, perhaps you go to the air, but the Leuzinger Olympians not known to go to the pass. And the way their defense has been playing, pitching a shutout last week, it might even be two down territory. Or will we see Hernandez put it up for the first time?
Again, man in motion, that's McClendon. He stacked up, he breaks through. McClendon picks up the first down, still going. It's gonna finally be drugged down, but not until after he makes a huge gain, takes it deep into Cougar territory, inside the 20, down to the 19, Dave.
Well, Rufus, when you can do that, you don't have to throw a pass. When you can get eight people up in the box, trying to go after one guy, and you get past that initial containment there, it is just Marcus Whittingham who we had to beat. They just blow everybody out. Last person with a chance to get him there, Elgin Simmons, and then you're going to see Marcus Whittington trying to strip him of the ball, but is able to bring him down to save the touchdown.
Once again, Olympians keeping it on the ground.
Looked like they fumbled that time, but they picked it up. Victor McClendon able to pick it up. Looked like he just bounced the exchange from quarterback Hernandez.
Could have been the old Nebraska fumble Ruski.
Oh, yeah. Well, they did that against Oklahoma a couple of times.
And Dean Steinkuhler, among others, was the action. I don't know whether it was Steinkuhler or Remington, but it's a Nebraska play. Second down. Hawthorne shows blitz. We got a flag on the play. We may have offside here against the Cougars. Got a procedure against the Olympians instead.
Well, I guess seeing that rushing lineman come in here forced someone to pull the trigger a little too soon, so that'll cost them 5 yards. Record-wise tonight, I don't know if we failed to mention, the losing Olympians overall 4-3-1. They're 3-2 in league as you take a look at the that last play there. For the Hawthorne Cougars, 3-5 overall, 2-3 in league. And there are right now three teams, Leuzinger, Redondo, and Beverly Hills at 3-2. Hawthorne and Peninsula at 2-3. So big nights tonight. Peninsula and Hawthorne could be both eliminated if they don't pull out wins.
Second and 15. Here's a pitch back to McClendon. McClendon still on his feet. Picks up about, well, it gets the five back and then some change. It's going to make it a third. Looks like about 7 or 8.
7:15 to go, and, well, you saw what they did the last. This is obviously two down territory, so they're not even concerned. They will obviously keep it on the ground.
They show it officially at the 7-minute mark as a third down and 9 for the Olympians. Ball just inside the Cougar 20-yard line. Pitch back to McClendon. He comes around the left. Hits a hole. They're starting to clog up right there in the middle.
Well, that time looked like they went off the left tackle for some success. And they're going to come up a little, well, depending on where the spot is, they haven't moved the down marker yet. But it's going to be close to that first down as you see the linesman holding his hand up. About 2 or 3 yards shy, so. Here your first big play of the night with 6:20 to go.
Fourth down for the Olympians. Fourth and 3. They're at the 12. They need to get to the 9. Again, that's Singleton. No, Well, it was Singleton, number two with the carry.
Yeah, he just slithered right on through there. And he's got the 1D first down, and they're knocking on the door. It's goal to go as we approach 5 minutes in quarter number one.
First and goal from the just outside the 5 yard line. There's the pitch and scored a touchdown. Touchdown for Victor McClendon. 5 yard TD run. Very methodical drive there, Dave, for the Olympians. Nothing strange. They kept the ball on the ground. McClendon did most of the work. Singleton got a carry or two. The big play in the drive was the Singleton, Victor McClendon run. As we watch the touchdown again, McClendon basically goes up the middle. That hit there, incidental to the touchdown.
And you see nothing but white jerseys there, just guiding him through as they will go for the two-point conversion.
And the two-point conversion is good. So Leuzinger jumps on top here in the first quarter at the 5:42 mark with an 8-0 lead, Dave.
That's Kava Makalo straight up the middle. He used to call his brother the freight train. He's a very similar running style, kind of hard to bring down. And we mentioned that first Leuzinger drive, not a whole lot of celebration, not a whole lot of... It's just very workmanlike. I mean, they march down the field, a couple of big third downs that they converted on. That third and five, the key from about the 40-yard line, when for most other teams it's probably a passing situation, but not for the Leuzinger Olympians. I mean, you know they're going to run, and they just keep bringing it right back at you. So it'll be the Hawthorne Cougars' turn to respond against a defense that pitched a shutout against Peninsula last week. And they're going to have to play with some emotion and precision if they want to have success tonight.
Well, Leuzinger controlled the ball for 6 minutes and 18 seconds there in the on their opening drive. Hawthorne now gets their chance. Squib kick handled by one of the up linemen. Now finally got in the hands of a running back. Chris Peopeo gets strung out at about the 34-yard line. So from... Actually, not the 34, let me correct that. The 29-yard line is where Hawthorne will go on offense for the first time. We get to see the Cougars.
And the Hawthorne Cougars on the line tonight. Jerry Coronado, the junior at center. Frank Velasquez will be at right tackle. Luke Lamperti will be the right guard. Left tackle will be Isul Velasquez. And Doug Foley will be the left guard. Starting quarterback tonight, Courtney Barton. Number nine, we'll get the backs and receivers for you after this first play.
Barton, one of the captains of this team. A lot of movement there. Now the flag comes in. Leuzinger doing some pointing, but we'll see whether the officiating crew agrees with their assessment.
And, of course, that's not a way to for an offensive lineman to get themselves mentioned by doing that. Let's go actually the offside this time. Taking a look at the rest of the offense for Leuzinger. Billy Mitchell, Momo Viamuanga, and Taron Jones are running backs, and Brian Goodall is a wide receiver. Courtney Barton, of course, can play more than one position, depending on where they need him.
Coach Swain this week in the newspaper saying that he was hoping that Barton, in fact, would be a bit more of a selfish player and take it himself, always looking to get his teammates involved to make it a participatory process, but coach believes that there are times when their offense is better served if he does it on his own.
That's what that Washington team wants Michael Jordan to do, eh?
Pump fake there by Barton, looks downfield. As we mentioned, one of the elements of their offense is passing. There's a flag there. Pass is complete. Hit it comes loose, but we got a flag before the pass.
Well, it was Armstrong on the hit of the pass intended there for Elgin Simmons. And, of course, when you see that flag go down, you figure it's got to be something in the Hawthorne backfield. Of course, being back there in that pocket, then it looks like they're going to get number 75 there for the Frank Colborkinson.
The indication there was that it was holding against the Cougars.
Hawthorne not off to a great start here this evening. Taking a look at the
starting defense for the Leuzinger Olympians. They play that 6-2. Brandon Ford, defensive end. Eva Hakofa, defensive tackle. Joseph Guerin, defensive guard. Finise Laloyo, defensive guard. And we'll get the rest of them for you in a second.
First and 20. Here's the pitch back. Billy Mitchell with the carry. And he's brought down as he goes wide left after a very short gain on the play.
Also on the line for Leuzinger, Maha Ikahifu, defensive tackle. Steve Singleton, defensive end. The two linebackers, Kava Makalo, inside linebacker, Paul Sikona, the other linebacker. Lumi Murray and William Martin are the corners. And Gerard Armstrong, who made that hit you saw a second ago, is the safety for Mike Whitt and the defense of the Leuzinger Olympians.
Billy Mitchell, of course, the workhorse back for the Cougars, having gained 760 yards on the season with four touchdowns on 122 carries. Once again, keeping it on the ground, very short gain on the play. Cougars needing to get out to just about the 40-yard line to pick up the first down.
It's Kava Makalo losing the helmet. And what is quite obvious, what's hurt Hawthorne this first series are the penalties. You just can't do that, especially when you're trailing and you are somewhat of an underdog, even though you're here on your home field.
Well, I think one of the things that would be in the Cougars' interest to do, certainly to stretch this Leuzinger defense some, would be, which they showed in earlier in the drive, put the ball up in the air. Looks like that's what they're going to do. Barton rolling out, brings it down. It's going to be stopped away short of the first down. Looks like it gets back to the original, to the line of scrimmage there. So it's going to be a fourth and about 11 or so, and the Cougars will have to punt it away.
Well, they're rushing six linemen against five guys on the line. I mean, the running backs have got to come and pick up. Brandon Ford was not picked up that time. He came in for the defensive end, and he put the initial pressure on Courtney Barton, which basically made the play go for naught. He just had to scramble around and not get much. So this first possession for the Leuzinger Olympians is Courtney Barton will have to punt, rather for the Hawthorne Cougars, and Leuzinger will get it.
Pretty good punt there by Barton. Takes a Olympian, excuse me, a Cougar bounce, and it's going to be down at about the 31-yard line. So a break there in the special teams play for the Cougars as they get off a pretty good punt. Leuzinger taking over at their own 31-yard line. First and 10, just under three left here in the first quarter.
Well, the Hawthorne Cougars being asked now to come up with a big defensive stop and get a call of, I think, an ineligible man downfield against Hawthorne. So they'll lose a little yards, but all in all, a pretty good punt as Leuzinger gets it on about their own 32-yard line to start their second possession.
Pitch back to McClendon. McClendon hits the hole. When he hits the hole, the pile just kind of moves, you know.
It's just amazing.
You can't even see him in there. You just see this mass of guys moving forward, and you know somewhere under there, Victor McClendon's legs are churning away.
When you watch Leuzinger Olympians hit the pile, sometimes you don't know who's got the football. I mean, they fool cameramen very easily. Cameramen, announcers, everybody.
I was about to admit to it, Dave. They do a lot of fooling of the announcers, and I would imagine it's a challenge for the defensive lineman down there to know who has it. There's a pitch this time to number 10. He's going to be met head up. That's Sikona.
Looks like he's going to have enough for the first down.
The defensive backs are getting in on a lot of hits, which isn't a good omen for the Cougar defense if they're getting into your defensive backfield before you're getting good solid hits to bring them down.
Yeah, they got four men up on the line, and they just getting right by that first wave easily as Hawthorne Cougars are going to take a timeout. Why, I don't necessarily know. I mean, it might be one of those emotional, as you see Coach Swain there, might be one of those situations that's saying, wait a minute, guys, it's gut check time here with 2:12 to go. But they have taken the timeout, and they trail 6-0 here in their home field.
Here at Helcap Field in Hawthorne, California, as we here at Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22, in conjunction with Hawthorne Community Cable and Time Warner Communications, are pleased indeed to bring in tonight's contest.
Well, this week, Courtney Barton, the big star, of course, with the Hawthorne Cougars, was quoted as saying, "This game is the most important game of the year," and of course it has double significance when you take a look at the playoff implications. He says families and schools have bragging rights, and since they've lost, when they lose this game, they hear it all year from their mates at Leuzinger, who could live right across the street from them or basically in the same vicinity. He says, "We haven't beaten them in 2 years, and we want to do it. It would be good to make the coaches happy. The game is emotional, and everyone will remember the game." Well, they've got their shot. Got their shot here tonight, but they're trailing 6-0, and they'll have to do it on the defense right now.
And it's a 2nd and 5 scoreboard is showing. Again, ball on the ground. Leuzinger picks up first down. That was Brandon Ford. As I mentioned last week, Ford's number was called quite a few times, and he himself had a big game.
Now talk about fooling cameramen and announcers. I mean, did anyone really see Ford come slithering? I mean, you're looking at number 11 there going right, and everyone is keying on him. In the meantime, look at Ford. He's already out of your picture before they catch up to him. I mean, that's deception. Inside handoffs, and losing Olympians do it well.
1st and 10 once again. Olympians with the ball on the ground. This time again, McClendon. Tell you what, fans, just so you'll know when you see them go by, let's tell you who these guys are by number. Number one in the backfield is Brandon Ford. Eddie Hernandez is number 7, the quarterback. Number 4, Victor McClendon. Number 10, Paul Sicona. And number 2, Steve Singleton. We've got 1.5 minutes left here in the first quarter. Losing are already leading by a score 8-0 as their side of the field starts to fill up with their fans. Here's a pitch back this time to number 11. Number 11 goes around the right corner. He picks up the first down, and that's Armstrong.
So Armstrong is the safety, starting safety, getting a couple of carries. Always at least 5 running backs did. Always when you look at the losing Olympians as we get the player down, I believe it's Mitchell. It's Billy Mitchell down and hurt right there, you see. But in the point we were making about losing her, there's always a star, one feature back, one or two guys who could be considered stars. There's usually 3 that it revolves around, but they're usually about 5 deep.
As you mentioned, of course, number 33 is Billy Mitchell, key offensive performer for the Cougars, as well as a defensive performer.
And it's one player they wouldn't want to lose in a situation like this. They need him there, need him in the backfield, big runner. And on the defense, he's playing soft side linebacker.
Well, there's an indication, now an indication from the coaching staff that I guess they're needing some additional assistance for him.
This has not been a happy first quarter for the Hawthorne Cougars. The crowd hasn't had much to cheer about. Talk about taking a crowd out of a ball game. That's what the losing Olympians have been able to do in 2 possessions, just taking it down the field.
As Mr. Mitchell is up, everybody give him a round of applause.
And Billy Mitchell going to have to limp something with that left leg. Hope it's not too serious. So they're going to need to carry him off.
Billy's getting carried off the field. Ladies and gentlemen, let's keep your prayers with him. Let's hope it's a very minor injury. Yeah. Hopefully we'll see him again tonight.
So we hope he will be okay. Mitchell is a senior. Senior year, want to finish up in your senior year in fine fashion. And we kind of hope he's okay. We'll see what kind of, we got some folks down on the sidelines. Who's down in the sidelines? Let's get a little report. Let's see if we can order some sideline service here. Do we have to hire somebody? Go down to the sideline. I'm talking to the PA announcer. Go down to the sidelines and get us a report. Well, let's send the soccer coach down there. Go down and get us a report.
As we prepare to come back to live action for a moment there you see.
We'll give you some pizza if you go down.
On the sideline. Seemingly okay. Judging from looking at him, and we'll get back to that in a moment. There's a pitch back, and on the pitch, McClendon picks up a couple of yards on the play. as he's down inside the 25 to about the 24.
Again, it looks to be about second and then about nine or so to go. And, you know, with that stoppage of play, we'll see with Mitchell, of course, one of the keys to this team. We'll see if the Hawthorne Cougars do respond here and kind of come together as a unit and try to stand things up as this quarter winds down.
Number 10 goes in motion around the side. That's Sakona. Sakona still on his feet. Sakona still grinding, picks up a first down. It's going to appear. That's Paul Sakona. Wouldn't be denied, Dave.
That obviously the best run of the night. I mean, you can't fault the Cougars' defense there. They did the best they could, but a lot of it was, I think you're going to see him phase off that, just wear off that first tackle attempt, and then the rest of it he pretty much gets on his own. I mean, this is quite an effort. I mean, it looks like somebody's going to get up and, looks like they, well, they could, somebody hit him. Actually, it was his old man, Hernandez, that looked like in trying to block, kind of pushed him toward the outside. And that play will end the quarter.
So, with one quarter in the books, Dave, the Olympians over here at Helcap Field, as we can see by the scoreboard, lead the Hawthorne Cougars by a score of 8-0 on Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22. As we take a view there of Billy Mitchell. Mitchell has taken off the shoulder pads. The situation becomes increasingly bleak, if you ask me. You see a guy take off his shoulder pads. It's not a good indication.
Yeah, and you know we're waiting to try to get a report on what possibly could be the extent of his injury, and we do hope everything is okay because, as he said, that does not look good. And he's a player that's done well for this team this year, and just got to hope for the best for him. A lot of concern. Everyone kind of, as you can see, huddled over him on that bench down there, on your screen, just kind of concerned on what his condition is.
We're trying to get, in fact, we're trying to get Guille in position to give us a sideline report.
Is Guille here tonight?
Guille is here, and I see her sideline.
All right. Guille used to, understand she used to go here a couple of years ago.
Now the Olympians moving from left to the right, more in a northerly fashion. Got a fumble on the play. Looks like it's going to be recovered by the Olympians.
Ball pops loose, but looks like Loser is going to recover it.
So the first turnover of the night from the Leuzinger perspective. Fortunately, they're able to recover. And this is a key series of downs right here. That's they force him back. Again, coming after that injury, he said that, you know, you want to kind of rise to the occasion to be inspired by the man who goes down. And this is definitely a stop that the Hawthorne Cougars are going to need if they want to stay competitive and stay in this ball game.
There's a fake again, one of those deals where we lost the ball. Number 8 that time for the Cougars with the carry. We, of course, know that that's Kava McCullough. Kava McCullough that time getting the carry. So by my count, Dave Leuzinger, he was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 backs tonight.
Wow, and Terry Infantineau, isn't he? He's not around anymore, is he?
No. But 6 different running backs here in just a little over a quarter and only 13 minutes of football.
Well, this is a key play here because they didn't gain much on it last, so it's about 3rd and 10.
Let's see if we can follow it. Okay, here's the pitch back to Sakona. Sakona's doesn't pick up the first down, but he gets inside the 10 or right down at about the 10-yard line.
And this play is even bigger because, of course, they're not going for a field goal. They don't really have anyone that can kick it. So for the Hawthorne Cougars, being asked to come up with a big stop right here and potentially keep themselves in the ball game. Don't want to get down, but they're already down 8-0. About 10 minutes to go until halftime. And they do want to get that trophy back.
So with 10 minutes to go, Leuzinger comes out fourth and six from the 10-yard line. McClendon gets the carry. McClendon still on his feet. He's going to be awfully close to the first down.
And to
this may be a spot situation, Dave.
To the naked eye, it looked for all the world like Eddie Hernandez was going to take that on the option. So you're focusing on him, and McClendon has the football.
Well, let's see what the indication is, fans. This will be the biggest call of the game to this point. Referees decide they want a little bit of help, so they're asking for the chain gang to come out and see.
This, of course, going to be a big spot right here. If it's a first down, he's got it at about the 3. And it would just about all.
Both teams with bated breath here wanting to see, trying to get an angle. Can't see from here, but the Cougars indicate that they're short. So it's going to be a Cougar ball first down. Their defense comes up with the big critical stop here, trailing by a score of 8-0. Leuzinger knocking on the door. 4th and 6 for the first down. They give them 5 3/4. They're going to take over on downs, Dave, as we watch the replay. Why don't you tell us?
And they're going to say that this defensive stand is inspired by Billy Mitchell, perhaps, as McClendon just not able to get what he needed. And, you know, we talk about how important it is from the Hawthorne perspective that they had to stop. What if they make that first down, it's almost a sure touchdown and just another run or so for losing Olympians. But, you know, think in terms of losing, or if this is a playoff game and they don't have the ability to kick a field goal, those could be 3 important points that they would have missed.
So from about their own 4-yard line, it's first down for the Cougars. They give it off that time to Tupou Bokaho.
So they're, of course, having to change things up somewhat.
KO picks up a little bit of yardage on the play. They're going to list it as a 2nd and 7. We've got 9:20 left in the first half, fans, here on Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22. Losing or leading by a score of 8-0. Once again, they keep it on the ground, looking for somebody else to carry. Remember, fans, Billy Mitchell is out. And that was Val Munga with the carry. Momo, if you see him on the street.
Well, 2 runs and not much yardage. Leuzinger playing a 6-2 defense. 6 defensive people up there on the line. Steve Singleton making the hit there that time. So finding not too much room to run, but you would think with 6 people on the line, if you could execute a little bit of time to get some sort of a pass, I guess who's going to be out there in pass coverage?
Well, here's the big 3rd down play. Barton drops back to pass. This one's going to sail out of bounds. Incomplete. Now, fans, we're ready. We've got an injury report from Guilla. Let's go down sideline to Guilla with the injury update on Billy Mitchell. Guilla, go ahead.
Hawthorne is still without Terrell Wilson, who they lost in our last broadcast of the Hawthorne game. And tonight they lose Billy Mitchell to a possible broken ankle. He will not play the remainder of the game. They will probably take him to the hospital. Back to Rufus and Dave.
Thank you, Guilla. And again, from the fine sideline crew here at Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22, you've gotten a report that there is an ankle injury to Billy Mitchell, probably done for the game, as it's considered to be severe. There's a punt by the Cougars, and referee's gonna spot that punt at the 45-yard line. So,
well, you heard Guilla say the tough loss a couple of weeks ago when they lost Simmons, and now this loss tonight definitely does not favor them, with them having to take him to the hospital. So that is losing a key ingredient that they need on both offense and defense. And somehow, if Hawthorne is going to pull this game out tonight, he's going to have to be the inspiration for pulling it out.
Well, he's going to need to inspire them yet again, as it's going to be 1st and 10 for the Olympians at the 45. There's a pitch back to Sakona. A lot of reaching and grabbing for the football now going on by the Hawthorne Cougars. And most times a coach will tell you the first best thing to do is to make the tackle.
Yes, of course, that's
wrap him up.
Rather than trying to go for the ball. You know, the comment I made a second ago about Hawthorne having to pull this game out, it's well, you'd say they're only down 8-0, but for the most part, their offense has been dormant. They haven't shown the ability to do much. So being down 8-0 is almost like being down 3 scores and only down one.
Glendon with the carry again as he goes around the left side. Looks like he's got enough for the first down. That would be awfully close. They're going to call it third down, so it's going to be about a third and one. Of course, the other thing with the loss of Mitchell Davis is that they lose a key component to their offense. I think it hurts them more offensively than it does defensively.
Oh, yeah, because he was a big back, 205 pounds.
760 yards on the season, their leading rusher. They show blitz. Leuzinger keeps it on the ground. McClendon goes the other way. And I don't think he got it. He lost about a half a yard on that play, so it's going to be fourth and still a yard or so. Actually, they're going to show it fourth and two.
Yeah, the blitz came up the middle, and it looked like it was Viamonga who was one of the people that got in there on Tolu Mowala. But, of course, they're going to go for it here on fourth down.
Ball is spotted at about 37. Actually, Hawthorne defense again with an opportunity to make a big play. There's the pitch back. Well, there's the first down. Then some. Now Sakona's going all the way. It'll be a touchdown for the Olympians. That's a 36-yard touchdown, 37-yard touchdown run for Paul Sakona.
How many times can we say a la John Riggins in Super Bowl 17? Everybody up in the box. You want to deny him the short yardage, but when you get past that wave, nobody can walk. Which is almost literally what he did. Get into the end zone, and Sakona puts the Leuzinger Olympians up 14-0 pending this 2-point conversion.
So as the Olympians prepare to go for the 2-point conversion, there's a pitch back again to Sakona. Sakona stretching out, goes out right, doesn't get it. So, a moral victory there of sorts. That's the indication there are flags on the field. Let's see how the flags impact as well. The Leuzinger gets another shot at it.
And it would be just adding insult to injury if this was something called on Hawthorne. Well, whatever it is, apparently it is on Leuzinger, so they will not get another opportunity. And it will remain 14-0. We see this again.
We got 6:15 left in this first half.
I don't know what the call was, but obviously against Hawthorne, rather against Leuzinger.
As they make the stop there. So as you can see, with 6:15 left in the second period, Leuzinger now leading by a score of 14-0.
And Rufus, the last time we sat in this booth a couple of weeks ago, I mean, forgetting, of course, your comment about the Yankees were going to be eliminated, but also that night we saw, I think we were saying, when's the last time we saw back-to-back kickoff returns with touchdowns? Well, I mentioned that to say you kind of get the feeling the way that this game is going is that one of the only ways for Hawthorne to really get back in this thing is they're going to need that kind of a big play. Because from scrimmage, you're not doing much. I mean, they need a kickoff return, a big one.
Absolutely. Doesn't look like they're going to get it here as that kickoff goes out of bounds. It'll be a penalty against the Olympians. And Hawthorne should take over at the 35-yard line, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, they're going to have good field position. But the thing is, I mean, for the Leuzinger Olympians' defensive perspective, pitching a shutout last week, they'll say, hey, we'll take it. You know, it's not that big of a deal, but the Hawthorne Cougars have got to be able to take advantage of something. And the running game is not going. You're seeing that there's an ability. They have time to pass. But that last pass attempt where it went out of bounds, is the receiver and the quarterback not on the same page. So we'll see what they elect to come out with here, Coach Swain.
So they're going to spot the ball at the 37-yard line. That's an application of a rule that I'll be honest with the fans, we're not entirely familiar with. That's what I want to look at. Typically, it's probably on one of the 5-yard lines, whether it's 25, 35, 40, or something. But at any rate, it's a first down for the Cougars. That's number 9, Courtney Barton, at quarterback. This is some of their best field position of the night.
And they've got 2 receivers to the far side, indicates a pass.
Only a 3-man rush, Barton. Barton can't find anybody open. The defense collapses on him. He's going to have to make some quicker decisions, I believe, Dave, with the ball to be effective.
Yeah, you hit it right on the head. It's a decision thing. And you would wonder at this point, of Kate, the more experienced quarterback, per se, is Tolu Mawala. I mean, unless he's hurt, they could maybe elect to go to him. I mean, he did. You got to get rid of it. I mean, if they're not open, you could throw that one out of bounds. But they look like momentarily there were a couple of people on the left side. He might have had a chance to hit and try getting that thing down there. You may get a pass interference or something.
Or you got to pull it down and run with it. But he's hanging in the pocket way too long, giving the defense more than enough time to crush the pocket. This time, nice handoff. It's going to be a flag on the play. That was a pretty looking. That was Tolu Mawala.
Brandon Ford with the ankle tackle for Leuzinger, but the good play goes for naught because they're going to get called for holding.
Referee indicates holding call against the Cougars. That's going to back them up another 10 yards.
And you know, Rufus, as you saw them line up, you kind of said, you know they're going to hand off right here. I mean, it looks like if I'm Hawthorne right now, I might consider passing on almost every down. I mean, what have they got to lose? I mean, they do have to win this ball game. They've got to get back in it. But why not challenge Leuzinger? Say, you know, make you guys have to come with some blitzes, do some things. I mean, it looks like he's got protection. They've got to get points.
With you. Yeah, I mean, it's the old Al Davis approach, the vertical game of stretching the field. Barton drops back the pass. This time, pass is completed. Opportunity for a first down, and it is. Nearly intercepted by the Olympians, but instead completed. And that pass is complete to Brian Goodall. And that's the biggest offensive play of the game thus far for the Hawthorne Cougars. And that nets them a first down, Dave, as they move into Olympian territory at the Olympian 48-yard line.
Yeah, you know, sometimes it doesn't pay to be good. You just got to be lucky. It looked like he was throwing for Naha and obviously overthrew Naha, but, of course, there's Goodall in the right position. So some good fortune. I mean, sometimes it pays to be lucky instead of skilled.
And I like what Goodall did there. Once he sensed the contact coming, he protected the football, picked up the first down, keeps the drive alive. Delayed handoff this time to number 3. Wallach being strung out, and he's going to pick up about 3 on the carry. Should make it a second down and 7.
It's good positive yard. I mean, 3 yards, but you see what that pass did, though. It kind of, you know, now Leuzinger's got something to think about there on defense. They can't just, you know, tee off on the runner. If they don't throw that pass in that last situation, I guarantee you he loses 3 yards, gets hit in the backfield as we have another Cougar down. There looks like Bo Cajo down on the sideline being attended to.
So it's a second down and 7 for the Olympians. Courtney Barton, their quarterback. Keeps it on the ground. That's Vi Munga with the carry. He's going to be 1 official by his placement. Indicates it's a first down. And that's what the side judge says as well. Move the chains. So the Cougars starting to show some offensive life, Dave.
They've got a little momentum, you know, that old cliche momentum right now. And, you know, this time they run out of a passing formation. You know, you got 2 receivers to the right, 1 to the left, and they're making Leuzinger defense have to think a little right now. Now, Leuzinger doesn't know what's there in an I formation, but if I'm Swain, I go to the air right here. They got a man in motion.
They come out of the eye, and they send a man in motion. Barton rolls right, throws back left. Pass is completed. Dangerous pass, but a completion nonetheless. That's one that you hold your breath on. That's not exactly what you want to do.
No, Rufus, I don't think that one was diagrammed that way. It looked like they were trying to set up a screen, but I think there was just no one but the receiver out there and not, I mean, this is dangerous. This is up for grabs. It's a wonder this one was not picked off. I mean, that's just a jump ball situation there, that the jump ball was lost by Steve Singleton.
Yeah.
Singleton loses to Moala. There was no one out there to block for on the screen. You want to have people down there getting ready to block, but again, sometimes it pays to be lucky instead of good.
Second and short. They're going to call it a second and two inside the Leuzinger 30-yard line. Man in motion comes this way. Quick slant pass over the middle. Incomplete receiver returned the wrong direction. That pass, Dave, intended for Pete Naha. Naha turned in. The pass was out.
But that's okay because they're thinking right. They're being aggressive now. They're attacking. They're not being predictable. And that was just off a little bit. The timing wasn't there. But they're doing it. Right now they're in two-down territory. They've got about a yard and a half to make. And they've got an outside shot with 2:29 to go of at least getting on the board before the end of the first half. And two timeouts.
And in second and short, that's the one you actually come with your pass play on. May even surprise them to come back with it again this time. As you say, if you look at it as four down territory. And it comes in motion. They drop back the pass. There's a pass over in the right flat. They've got the first down. That's good all again with the first down.
It looks like it's going to bring up first down.
So, Cougars now starting to click in the passing game, which I mentioned earlier in the pregame show, being the edge. And, of course, now with Billy Mitchell being out, they're going to have to rely on the passing game probably a lot more than before. As you see, Courtney Barton roll out right, find Brian Goodall in the right flat. Goodall picks up the first down. A few other positive yardage as he gets down to about the 21-yard line, where it's first and 10 for the Cougars.
Well, they're going to force losing their coach Mike Whitt to reconsider this 6-2 defense right now, because that's not going to work for a team that can pass well, that's doing well on the passing situation.
Clock rolling under 2 minutes and a half. There's a pitch to Moala. Moala picking up positive yardage on the play as he goes down inside the 15 to about the 14-yard line. That's a gain of nearly seven. They need to get to the 11 for the first down. Let's call it a second down and a long two.
Momo via Mwanga with a big block there out leading it. And this is a different Hawthorne Cougar team than we saw before this last kickoff. These guys are alive and playing some good, inspired football right now. What they don't need right here, you know, even worse than not scoring would be a turnover. If they're stopped here before the end of the half, that's one thing. But if they commit a turnover and a big penalty or something like that, that would be worse than just having losing or throw it back in your face.
Taking a lot of time on this drive, clock down to just a minute. Ball's up in the air in a dangerous area. It's incomplete. Let's take a commercial break, fans, right here on Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22. And fans, we're back. There you can see. Haven't missed a thing. Third down play for the Cougars. Barton sticks it on his arm. He's got some running room. Barton turns it up. He's got the first down. It's going to be first and goal inside the 5-yard line at about the 4. So with 58 seconds left, a little hometown clock management here. Doesn't look like the clock moved a single second, brother.
Hometown clock management, huh?
I tell you, man, it's nothing like it, brother. You know.
Well, on that play, the corner for Leuzinger didn't bite like they did the last time Leuzinger ran that play with Barton rolling out right and when he found Goodall out there on the right flat. This time, being that he didn't bite, didn't come up on it, he was able to run it and get enough yards for the first down. So 40 seconds and running, Hawthorne has two timeouts.
First and goal from the 4. Barton under center. Interesting to see how they handle this. And they're going to be awfully close. I think they're going to be just short. They're getting down inside the area where they need to use one of those timeouts, and now we get the indication that they will. So that was Villamunga with the carry. From the indication here, Dave, he's down right at the half-foot line.
And, of course, with one timeout left, well, take a look at a couple of scenarios. If they don't get in here, it's third down. They can call a timeout, and yeah, they're in pretty decent shape. Now, what Leuzinger, of course, now, you know, forget the 6-2. You go to the goal line defense as you look at Coach Whitt. Leuzinger has not been scored on in quite a while. They lost to Beverly Hills 14-6 2 weeks ago at home. Last week they pitched a shutout against Peninsula 22-0, a game that we did down at Olympian Field. So right now they're they've gone 5 quarters. This would be the 6th quarter. They're 23 seconds away from having 6 quarters in six quarters without being scored on, but that is definitely in jeopardy right about here now. Losing her fans on the other side of the field, all up on the bleachers, and the Hawthorne fans on the near side of the field where we broadcast from. So this is big. One more timeout. It is second down, and they've got a couple of shots as Coach Swain comes off the field.
I think, just as they'd say in the NFL, this one's simple, brother. This is quarterback straight up the middle. And there you got it. Touchdown. Indication. Touchdown. There's nothing to do there. You're half a yard away. Anything is a risk, you know. A handoff's a risk. A pass a risk. If Courtney Barton can't make a half yard, then you're in for a long, long night. But we know that he can, and he did. So with 20 seconds left here in the first half, Hawthorne gets on the board courtesy of the one-yard Courtney Barton quarterback sneak.
And the Hawthorne Cougars need this conversion. If it's going to look like it's going to be a one with doing the kicking. Courtney Barton
snap
is a place
high,
kicker.
The kick is up, and it's good. It was a low-line drive, but it's good. And the Cougars cut it in half.
Okay, Juan Bus, get now, get Rufus. Guess what player did that? Juan Becerra. And guess what sport he plays? He plays soccer. We got my man, the soccer coach, in the booth. See, we need an extra mic up here. We had the extra mic last week at down to Leuzinger. We need an extra mic, but let's give him his props. It was up and straight through. May I ask, what position does he play on the soccer team? He's a goaltender? Now that's a prayer, because you know goalies don't kick. So, I mean, you know, well, they have to kick defensively, but they don't kick goals. So the fact that he kicked that one straight up and through there, let's give it to him because they need that point. Now they're within seven as take a look at it. And, of course, give credit to the placeholder, Tolu Mawala. Of course, he's got to spot it well, and long snapper on the play. Got the long snapper is always a key there. Pete Naha, so on those situations, you need your snapper, your placeholder, and your kicker. And that's one aspect of the game that Leuzinger does not have, the ability to score from the field.
And when do we want to go to Deborah? Okay. Now? Well, after the kickoff. Okay, at the half. Thank you.
And you're hearing us live instructions going out over the air here. Anarchy in the booth with 20 seconds to go till halftime.
And here's a kickoff. Bit of a squib kick taken by one of the up men, number three for the Leuzinger Olympians. Of course, in the Leuzinger program, you have to scramble for the numbers. One of the few teams we cover that don't put the roster in numerical order.
Well, would you prefer that they have a good barbecue every week or have a good roster? I mean, that they get good barbecue down in Leuzinger now. I mean, you know, it's like it's either the roster, the press box, or a barbecue. Well, 20 seconds to go.
Considering we get a roster, I'll take the barbecue. Of course, number three is Lumi Murray. I want to get Lumi's name in the broadcast tonight. Just had to dig in and find it there, Lumi.
And with 20 seconds to go, I don't think you're going to see anything fancy.
If I were you, Lumi, wearing number three, I'd suggest to him that they put it in numerical order so my name would be at the top of the roster. Drive back the show pass, of course. That didn't fool much of anybody. The referee's going to blow the play dead, although Hernandez isn't down. He was contained. And we've got about 10 seconds left. Leuzinger has a couple of timeouts. Let's see if they elected to use them. Don't look like they will. And we're going to end the first half here at Helcap Field. Contest was a little slow starting on the Hawthorne side. Picked up in the second quarter. And right now the Cougars trail by only a score of 14-7. We've got Deborah Savage down on the sideline, fans. Let's see if we can go down to Deborah right now. Deborah Savage, take it away.
All right, now, ladies and gentlemen.
This matchup between Hawthorne and Leuzinger is full of excitement tonight. Leuzinger wasted no time ensuring why they have the trophy. Victor McClendon, with just 6 minutes to go in the first half, rushed for 84 yards, scoring the first touchdown. Captains number 10, Kava McCallo, scored the two-point conversion. During the second half, Paul Sacona rushed for 37 yards, bringing the score to 14-0. But in the second quarter, Leuzinger kept Hawthorne's offense to scoreless until just before 20 seconds before the quarter ended, quarterback Courtney Barton scored a touchdown. Back to you in the booth.
Thank you very much, Deborah. And there you have it, an excellent recap of our first half action here at Helcap Field by our understudy, Deborah Savage. Fans, we're going to take a break here at halftime on Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22. We'll join you for second half action in just a few moments. Pushes us around. Well, fans, we're back for a second half action here at Helcap Field as the Leuzinger Olympians lead the Hawthorne Cougars by a score of 14-7. We've got a chance to go down to Scott Goodman for some halftime stats before the second half kickoff. Scott, go ahead.
The majority of the first half was dominated by the Leuzinger Olympians until the waning moments when Courtney Barden scored on a 1-yard quarterback sneak for the Cougars. Olympians have dominated throughout the game, netting almost 200 yards rushing, and they keep it up in the second half. It could be tough for the Cougars to get back into the game. Back up to you, Rufus and Dave.
Thanks, Scott. Excellent report there. Scott certainly has more data than that, and we'll get some of it in a little while. But right now, we're ready for the second half kickoff. And Hawthorne, of course, deferred in the first half, so they get it here in the second. Barton picks it up there. And he's out at about the 32-33-yard line, which is actually where, well, their touchdown scoring drive there in the second quarter. Dave started at the 37. This drive is going to start at about the 33, where it'll be first and 10 for the Cougars.
And we, of course, will see what the coaches elect to go with at the half. That touchdown that Hawthorne scored before the half was the first points that Leuzinger has given up since the Beverly Hills game when they lost 14-6. They pitched a shutout against Peninsula last week, and they came in with a 6-2 defense against Peninsula designed to stop the running attack of Peninsula, not worry too much about the pass. Well, Hawthorne did it mainly in the air on that last series, so we'll see how they elect to adjust.
Hawthorne sends three receivers into the formation, puts one in the slot, sends another man in motion. Right now, they're showing a couple of different looks here to the Olympians. Barton drops back to pass. He's going deep. It's over the middle, and it's going to be intercepted. Intercepted by Gerard Armstrong. So, not the kind of way that the Cougars wanted to start the second half. Their fans giving them a bit of the business there as you watch the replay here. Barton drops back to pass.
And losing a rushing only four down linemen, the corner staying in, but this just the safety, Gerald Armstrong, out there where he's supposed to be as it's overthrown. And the receiver double covered that time. So good double coverage on the wide receiver, Marcus Whittington.
So on the first play from scrimmage, the Cougars give it back to Leuzinger. And of course, you see McClendon here being gang tackled.
Nice defense there by the Cougars.
Defense showing a better effort by the Cougars, at least out the gate here in terms of containing the run.
And they will need it. Starting on the line for losing her second half, Finisay Lolela, Joseph Guerin, center Miguel Peralta, Tony Morgan, right guard Hiva Hakofa, the right tackle, tight ends Maha Ikehifu, and Daniel Navas. Eddie Hernandez starting quarterback, and the three backs, Paul Sikona, Steve Singleton, and Victor McClendon, the running backs for the Leuzinger Olympians.
Second down and 8 for the Olympians as the ball is at about the 32-yard line. Pitch back to McClendon. McClendon hits a hole. He's going to be knocked down, but not until after he picks up about 3 more on the play. It's going to make it 3rd and 4. It's just across the 35, and the yard mark is just inside the 40.
And lest we remind you folks, of course, that if Leuzinger wins tonight, they will lock up a playoff position. You have to come in 1 through 4 in the division to guarantee a playoff position. If Hawthorne loses, they will be eliminated.
Got the flag on the play, whistles on the play, stopping it. Deer with the carry is number 1, Brandon Ford. Dave, you talk to the good folks over at Leuzinger. I must admit, I'm intrigued by. Okay, sorry about that. I was gonna say, Dave, you talk to the good folks at Leuzinger. I'm intrigued by their roster. I know maybe there's some system here that we're supposed to see that I don't quite understand. It's not in alphabetical order. It's not in numerical order. It's not by grade. Yeah. Can you ask them, can you use your persuasory skills with the folks over there to ask them if they can provide us for later in the season a numerical roster? Ball still kept on the ground, losing her. Brandon Ford with the carry picks up the first down as he takes it out near midfield. They're going to put it at the 40, at the 44-yard line. That's about as close to midfield as he got, quite frankly. But it will be a first and 10 for the Olympians.
Well, Rufus, if I tried to fulfill that request, they'd say, Mr. Marks, we don't make programs, we run the football. And when you see that sort of situation that there, when the camera can't pick up the proper running back, you know that their running game is getting back in proper form.
And he got a flag in the backfield.
Looks like he picks up the first down, but there is a penalty marker.
Okay.
Well, this one is going to come back. One thing that we say about Leuzinger, for the most part, with their running attack, they don't make the mistakes. Last week they made one key one on their first drive in the win against Peninsula. And the first big holding comes here at this opening drive for them in the second half. So that's going to set them back a little bit with the 14-7 score. Yeah, it's a Leuzinger. They kind of do things an interesting way down. I don't mean in a bad way, but it's a unique situation down there on Rosecrans at their school with the flame burning at Olympian Field in the background. And of course, we've done basketball games from there. I've done baseball games from there, and I've done softball games from the top of a van there at Leuzinger before.
And it won't be long till basketball season, but right now we've got a football game as the Olympians have it. They're backed up. It's a first and about 20 for them. So that was a break for the Cougars. Cougars, of course, needing a defensive stop here. They had the opening possession to start the second half on their first play from scrimmage. They throw the interception. So that drive fizzles on them. But they've got Leuzinger in a bit of a hole here with a second and long. And an opportunity to perhaps get the ball back in pretty decent field position if, in fact, they can make the defensive stops. There's a pitch back to Sakona, and he's wrapped up there after a pickup of about three or four.
And it's Dwayne Smith in there on the hit. Of course, in the first half, Billy Mitchell, soft side linebacker, went down with some sort of an ankle injury. He was taken to the hospital. That's the word we got on him in the first half.
So this is where the Cougar defense can bear down and come up with a big play and give their offense an opportunity at the ball. I think it's too long if they're able to make the stop here for the Olympians to go for it on fourth down. But you got to make the play first. There's the fake to McClendon. He drops back to pass again. And a sack on the play for the Cougars.
Sione Viamonga in on the hit. And of course, well, I don't say this to be snide or anything, but of course, passing is not the Leuzinger Olympians game. They don't practice it, they don't do it. And
well, as you see the fake there, one of the things that's for sure is that the key there is that the defense doesn't bite on it. You know, normally, if you have a passing attack, that will cause a momentary pause in the defense as they got to decide whether to play the pass or continue to rush. These guys never change. There's a high snap, but they get it away. Pretty decent kick there by number 45. Takes a Hawthorne bounce. Going to be down by the Olympians, and it's going to be down at about the 35-yard line. So with 7:24 left in the third quarter, Leuzinger leading by a score of 14-7. Hawthorne's going to get the ball back at their own 35-yard line. Their second possession here in the second half.
And you just said a key thing a second ago, Rufus, about having to respect that ability to pass. This ball game has turned around by the fact that Hawthorne has made Leuzinger have to respect the ability to pass. I mean, we're not looking at Daryl LaMonica to Cliff Branch or Stabler to Branch or Namath to Maynard, but they're doing something to make the Leuzinger defense have to think about it, and that's a key.
Barton on the center out of the I formation to give it to the second back through. No gain on the play, but a flag comes in from the referee, who is positioned behind the line of scrimmage. Normally an indication that it's going to be a holding call, but let's see for sure.
Maha Ikahifu getting all in there, number 9 on your screen, defensive tackle.
And they line up four down linemen and two on the outside, basically a 6-2.
Holding is the call. Declined, however, by Leuzinger. They elect to take the down. Makes it a second and 12. A little bit of respect there being shown for the, I would suppose, for the Hawthorne offense, rather than giving them another down. Would have been a first and 20.
And this is the sort of situation where you might elect to, well, let's see what kind of formation they come. Come in what looks like a running formation. Now they're going to break three people off to the right. Let's say you might want to do a draw or something. Keep them off balance.
Backfield still split, and now they use a timeout. Barton calls a timeout here at the 6:41 mark of the third quarter, with Leuzinger leading by a score of 14-7 on Lawndale's Community Cable channel number 22, along with Hawthorne Community Cable and the good folks at Time Warner Communications making this broadcast possible. Of course, next week we come back here for a contest between the Hawthorne Cougars and the Normans of Beverly Hills.
And depending on what happens tonight with Hawthorne and Leuzinger and what Beverly Hills does tonight, it will determine if that ball game is going to mean something for either of the schools, because the scenario is if Hawthorne were to lose tonight plus Beverly Hills and Redondo win, Hawthorne is eliminated, and basically you've got your four playoff teams. MiraCosta is in, Leuzinger would get in, and that would mean both Beverly Hills and Redondo would be in, so next week's game would be meaningless. However, if Hawthorne pulls this game out, well, all bets are off, and you got a lot of teams fighting for position next week. That would mean basically if Hawthorne were to pull this game out, Beverly Hills and Redondo probably get in. Beverly Hills tonight is playing against West Torrance, and Redondo's playing against Peninsula, having a bad season. So that would mean next week losing or one of them is going to be eliminated, losing or Hawthorne next week. We'll get to
backs
that in a second.
Split. Barton drops back to pass, has some time, looking over his coverage, brings it down, looking for a block out front, still looking to pass. Now he's got some running room, now looking to run on his feet, and about a 40-yard run for Barton to pick up a one-yard gain.
And if it's not again for Maha Ikahifu, he's been a rover the last two plays. He got in there on that play that caused the penalty. And Ikahifu is lined up on the right side. Okay, he's being hit by two people. He gets hit for a third time. Now Ikahifu makes the initial rush. Now Ikahifu is down. He doesn't give up. And he's the one who's eventually going to get back up and come across field and make the tackle here. Good play. If he's not able to get back into the picture, he's going to break that off for a lot more yardage.
And that was an excellent block there by Tulu Moala there on one of the Leuzinger defenders. Barton again dropping back to pass, has some coverage here. He's going to overthrow his intended receiver, nearly intercepted by number three, Lumi Murray. Second time we've called Lumi Murray's name tonight. Remember calling his name in the first game of the season inadvertently. Two times a night, it's been on the money.
Yeah, good little defensive stand there by Leuzinger. And, of course, with the Hawthorne Cougars, the inability to have a second option. I mean, they kind of knew where Barton was going that particular time with the ball. And that played a big key. So they have to punt with 5:38 to go.
Lumi being a senior, and this being our last broadcast of Leuzinger football, perhaps for the season, getting his name mentioned as much as possible tonight. There's the Cougar punt. It's going to be downed by the Cougars at the 26-yard line, where the Olympians will go on offense at the 5:28 mark, leading by a score 14-7 here in the third quarter at Helcap Field.
Well, let's get that Bay League situation set for you. Of course, here tonight, the battle for the Mayor's Cup. West Torrance at Beverly Hills. If Beverly Hills wins, they're in, and they'd be the favorite. Culver City at MiraCosta. Forget it. MiraCosta's got the Bay League first place sewn up. Peninsula at Redondo is the X Factor game. If Redondo would be favored, but if Peninsula loses, they will be out of the playoffs for the first time in their school's history, and Redondo gets in. So if you're betting smart money, of course there is no smart money, really. You'd figure Beverly Hills and Redondo are in. Leuzinger has to win to get in. If they lose, then next week becomes very interesting.
That's number
On the first down carry, that's McClendon. In this half, the Cougar defense has done an outstanding job. Now we've got numerous flags on the play.
Now this is where it's getting a little chip. This game is very much on the line, and it's getting edgy right about now. This is, you know, you talk all that stuff about, oh, it's a big rivalry, it's a this and it's a that. Well, now you're seeing it right here. This is this is where it's getting a little tough and a little physical right here.
Well, hopefully we'll have the old offset and penalties, and everything will be a wash and we can move on. Got a personal foul against the Cougars. Got a personal foul against the Olympians. Penalties offset, so none of it ever happened. It's second down.
And they'll just do it over behind that Cougar bench. Got some substitutes there, some guys who on the taxi squad, as they would say if they were in the NFL.
So it's a second down and 10 for the Olympians. Olympians need to get out across the 35 to the 36. To the 36 for the first down. It's Eddie Hernandez, you see there, quarterback, number 7. We'll watch, see if we can see the ball moving. There's a pitch back to Sakona, and he's brought down after a very short gain on the play.
They're getting between those linemen now and penetrating, and if Hawthorne is able to effectively stop the run, and I say effective when they normally can peel off 7 to 8 yards a pop and they're only getting 2 or so here and they're not peeling off the big ones, then their defense is going to set their offense up in pretty decent shape.
Well, their defense has certainly settled down. Leuzinger started out as if though they were going to blow the doors off of this game. Jumped out to the 14-0 lead. They were controlling the ball offensively and controlling it defensively. Hawthorne finally had a measure of success late in the second quarter. Thus far here in the third, with 4 minutes left, haven't had a chance to get on track yet. But their defense has been stepping up and keeping them in the game, as the defense is going to create another fourth down situation here, fourth and about 3.
And not even the Olympians, I think, are going to go for it in this position. This has got to be a punt situation there for Leuzinger, which
is there an echo in here? Every time I say something, I'm hearing somebody repeat what I say. I say 4th and 3. I hear somebody say 4th and 3. I say 3rd and 8.
It's a track coach on the PA, Mike.
Oh, okay.
No, you're listening to cross country track. He's listening to you, and you're listening to him. You know that's how it goes. He said, "Great minds think alike." Well, okay. If you say you guys aren't from New York, so that does. Oh, you are from New York, man. Yeah, that's right up.
High snap, they get the kick away. They do, but there's going to be a flag on the play. It's a rough and a kicker play. Crowds getting excitement out of this, but all of this means absolutely nothing, as there's going to be a rough and a kicker on Tolo Moala. Means absolutely zero, fans.
Well,
as Chick would say, you could call it with Braille. And this won't be an offsetting situation either, because that's going to be the first penalty, which will give them an automatic first down.
Now, Coach Swain is talking to one of the officials. You know he doesn't agree with this. This is probably going to give them a first down. And they were within 3 yards of the first. So if it's a 5-yard penalty, they've got the first down.
No, well, he's marching out the big one on this. We've got the replay. I think we can see this. Cougars, of course, arguing that the ball was tipped. That, of course, is Moala, the guy who it was against.
And after the penalty, that's going to bring up first down now for Leuzinger.
We're going to watch the replay here, fans, see if the ball was, in fact, tipped. First of all, it was a very high push snap by the Leuzinger center. Nah, the ball was gone. He never touched the ball. So, good call by the officiating crew there. Tough break for the Hawthorne Cougars. And then you'll see this hit here at the end. Boy, you talk about taking a hit for nothing. That's number 45 for the Olympians, who lays a good lick. We'll get back to that in a second. This is McClendon. Once again, the defensive line doing a good job of stacking McClendon up. Not sure if we got number 45 in our program for the Olympians.
Could be Nahas.
Okay.
Well, not exactly sure, but yeah, nobody – nobody seems to have him in the program here tonight, so he doesn't exist.
Okay, so second and eight now for the Olympians. Ball just over the 40-yard line. Cougar defense having to spend a lot of time on the field right now, Dave, as we're at the 2:24 mark of the third quarter. And eventually that's going to bite them, but they make a big play here. Let's get a mention here. That's Chris Pea.
Yeah, and it looked like a little confusion there with Eddie Hernandez.
Got to say, that's one of the advantages of being up here with the Hawthorne House announcers, is that we get the correct pronunciations on these names, because that, if you look at it to me, P-E-A-P-E-A spells P-P. And I was going to call him Chris P-P to me, you know.
Guys in the truck, hit the delay button.
But they say it's Pea Pea. Well, that's why I spelled it first. P-E-A is P. Sakona with the carry. The Hawthorne defense. The Hawthorne defense, you got to give them credit, Dave, where it's due. They have played outstanding since, quite frankly, we look back at since the 6:15 mark of the second quarter.
Yeah, it's a different ball game, and with about a minute 15 to go in this quarter here, this game is very much on the line. It's going to be a matter of who wants it.
Clock continues to run. You can bet this time special teams will be on guard. Another high snap. Okay, and they definitely stay away from it. And they're going to wisely get away from it. Very good decision there by Courtney Barton, who was back there along with Elgin Simmons. Ball is down by the Olympians at the 29-yard line, where it's going to be first and 10 for the Cougars here at Helcap Field with 52 seconds left in the third quarter. They trailed, Dave, by a score of 14-7, but still plenty of time left to get something going.
And as far as the punter for we've seen the last couple of plays, I'm going to venture to guess that it's Daniel Navas, because he's changed numbers. He was number 51 a couple of weeks ago. He was 42 last week, so we're not sure. We could maybe get that confirmed from the sideline, but I think it is, because Navas is listed as a punter.
Well, Navas is doing a good job. It's the snapper who's creating a problem for him. I mean, he's had to handle bad snaps all night long. This time, number four for the Cougars with the carry. That's Bo Tupou.
Well, if we're going to go there, Maha Ikahifu is supposed to be the long snapper for the Leuzinger Olympians with 36 seconds to go.
So, with 30 seconds in the third, we've got a second and nine play coming up here for the Cougars. I think they'll get this play off before the end of the quarter. Barton still running them at quarterback. Out of the eye, they split. Now they bring a man in motion to this side of the field, as you can see. They fake the handoff, drop back the pass. Barton still looking. Barton needing to get rid of it. Still looking. Lays it up there. And it's completed to Pea Pea.
And you got to believe that Pea Pea came back for the ball that time to rescue his quarterback. We mentioned that a couple of weeks ago. Receiver, you got to come back. Got to know where your quarterback is and come back. If he doesn't come back, it's either a loss or a sack. But instead, it's positive gain and brings him close to a first down as quarter number three comes to a close.
It's going to make it a third and short. And exactly right, Dave. We've got three quarters in the book. No scoring in that quarter, fans. Our score after three, Leuzinger 14, Hawthorne 7 on Channel 22's Football Game of the Week here in the South Bay.
Well, does Coach Guidi get a chance to retrieve that cup? The Mayor's Cup has been a little south of here for the last 2 years.
Well,
Mayor Hofmann has still got it, still in his possession, and he's got 12 minutes to decide whether he's still going to be holding it or not.
Now, have we checked the rule book? Do we know what the ruling is in the event,
of a tie? Like I said, like minds think alike. That is, well, maybe if it's a tie, it spends half the year in Lawndale and spends the other half at Hawthorne or something. Maybe that's how it works. Last year, of course, in Division, or was it 2 years ago in Division One, Long Beach Poly and Mater Dei were declared co-champ. I think there was a tie in the Division One championship, the CIF Southern Section Division One game, and Modern Day and Long Beach Poly were declared co-champions. Well, of course, last year Poly took care of that when they won the game outright. And for those of you talking about that, a couple of weeks, Concord De La Salle came down here and showed everybody who's boss in California with that ball game against Poly a couple of weeks ago.
And Veteran Stadium, sold out crowd, 15,000 people.
Oh yeah, that's Division One. This is Division Three you're looking at right here, and they do play some good football in Division Three as well. Hart is the favorite. Hart, Notre Dame, those sorts of schools, favorite.
Third and three for the Cougars. They get the first down. Big first down. That's Momo Vamunga with the carry. Keeps their drive alive. Huge third down pickup there for the Olympians.
And as this quarter starts, we, you know, say the Mayor's Cup is not the only thing on the line. Hawthorne has to win in order for them to have a playoff shot. If they win, they are still alive. Of course, they'd have to beat Beverly Hills again next week. If they lose, they are out. Leuzinger is in. And a Hawthorne win tonight and a Leuzinger victory means that both of them have to win to get a shot next week. And, of course, it also depends on what Redondo and Beverly Hills do tonight. So when you see this ball game tomorrow, the picture will be a little clearer when this tape is played back. Sunday at 7 o'clock. So it's Sunday now if you're watching this.
This time the keeper on the ground, fumble on the play. Looks like Barton got on it. We're going to see if we can get the house announcer to indicate to the fans that this game will be broadcast on Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22 Sunday night at 7 p.m.
And what time does it come on in Gardena? Gardena and Gardena, Torrance, all over the place.
That's Sunday at 7 on Channel 22, Tom.
Now if someone's in New Mexico with a satellite on their roof and they have a transponder, how can they get, well, we'll get into that later.
Okay, you guys can get to us in a second. We're back to live action here. It's a second down 11. Pass out in the flat to Goodall. Goodall picks up about 6 on the play. It's going to make it, well, 5.5, and it's going to be third and about 5.5.
And that was well timed because Charles Lewis was right there. If that pass hangs up a little more, Charles Lewis is either going to make some contact or he's got the interception. So it's going to bring up about the third and 5 to go for the first down. So we approach 10 minutes to go in the ball game.
So third down and 5 play. Cougars looking to keep this drive alive. Very important. There's a pass. This receiver never turned around. That pass intended for Momo Vamunga. Vamunga didn't turn around. So Cougars now in a bit of a decision of their own.
Well, whereas Peapea made the right decision by turning around, coming to the quarterback, I mean, that just kind of inexcusable as far as the coaching staff would say. You got to know where the quarterback is. If he turns around, he's got the first down very easily, but instead is going to put them into a punting situation. Courtney Barton will have to punt, and the drive will end here apparently for the Hawthorne Cougars. No, but a fake.
Pass in the flat. Goodall has the first down. Big first down there for Brian Goodall. They go for it on first down. They pick it up. They needed to get to the 45. They, in fact, get to the 35.
Well, James Swain, the head coach, deciding to go for the fake, and it continues the drive. They snap it back, and, of course, doing the throwing is Richard Badimaha. He's the placeholder and backup quarterback, a lefty, and he completes the pass to Goodall, and that keeps the drive alive. So out of the Bill Parcells playbook, how about that? Parcells was known to do that in the fourth quarter of game. You think of the Giants, San Francisco 49ers, NFC Championship game about 10 years ago up in Frisco. And the drive continues here with approaching 9 minutes to go.
Barton drops back the pass, lays it up deep. Good pass that time. Do we get, looking for the flag? Some folks thinking the flag is due. Hawthorne asked for one.
Incomplete, intended for number 6, Brian Goodall.
That was... Barton's best throw of the night, Dave.
Oh, yeah.
It was a nice tight spiral.
You see Goodall waving his arm there at coverage on the play. Gerard Armstrong covering deep, of course. He picked one off earlier in this half. And whenever you go deep like that, that is the danger of having that center fielder back there just ready to pick it off. So second down. Do they go to the draw to keep him honest?
Second and 10 here. Bad snap, mishandled. Looks like Barton has recovered it, though, which is key right now. With 9:45 left in the game, Cougars needing to take advantage of this possession and this good field position. I said 9. The indication is that it's 8.5 minutes left in the game.
And that, of course, the second time on this particular drive that they've had that mishandle from center to quarterback. Jerry Coronado, the junior, is a center.
So in two downs, they've netted 0 yardage. It's a third down and 10 now. They're at the 35, needing to get to the 25 to keep this drive alive. But this clearly, I think you would agree, Dave, is two down territory.
And you may even try to run here, figuring you're going to go for the football. No, they'll come out to pass.
And Martin drops back to pass, lays it up again. He's got a receiver! There was that pass intended for Elgin Simmons. And boy, that one went right through the hands. I got to give Barton credit. His first couple passes in the game were a bit shaky, but as the game has gone on, his passes are starting to look very pretty. And boy, you talk about one there. That one was on the money. That's money. That's bank there. Elgin, my brother, hate to say it, but that's a drop.
Well, your sentiments echoed by the full house here at Hawthorne from the Hawthorne contingent. It's fourth, and they will go for it at this stage of the ball game, knowing that time is going to be a factor pretty soon.
Cougars go again, looking at Goodall coming across the middle. Barton still rolling. Goodall in the backfield saying, throw it to me. He's trying to get there. He's not going to make it, though. Barton decided to run it. Barton needed 10. He got 8. It's going to go over on downs to the Olympians. Goodall did get open in the end zone. I could see it from my vantage point, and I'm not sure that Courtney could see it because he certainly has the arm to get it there, so he obviously could not see him as he was rolling in that direction, and the ball's going to go over on down to the Olympians. Here you see Barton looking back to pass. Starts to roll out to his left. You won't see it in this picture, but right about now, Goodall is deep in the left-hand corner of the end zone, waving his hand, indicating through it. Barton near in position to pick up yardage, but the Leuzinger defender along the sideline knocks him out. Leuzinger gets the ball, first down for the Olympians, and once again, their defense will be called upon. The Cougar defense, I'm speaking of, to make a stand here with 7:30, clock running. Helcap Field, Leuzinger leading by a score of 14-7. Hawthorne's best opportunity here in the second half, Dave, goes up in smoke.
And the Olympian crowd on the far side of the field up and cheering after they failed to make that fourth down. And now it's a matter of can Hawthorne continue to fight, or do they have some of the fight taken out of them as a result of that?
Well, I think a little bit, but they're going to have to make some stops. Right now, they've just given up one first down. That's not as much of a problem because I think they've still got 3 timeouts in their pocket. I'm not sure whether they've got the full complement. I think that they do. Number 11, Armstrong, gets up there.
They've got 2. They did take one earlier.
Okay.
But they pretty much know what's coming, the losing Olympians. Another touchdown here pretty much salts it away. They've got to avoid the penalties. And ball control for them when you consider that they held the ball last week against Peninsula for 30 minutes. Right now for Coach Whitt and his losing Olympians, it's one more drive, fellas, and that could be about it.
McClendon keeping the ball on the ground. McClendon stopped after a short gain. This drive, though, and we spoke about this a little bit earlier in the second half when the Cougar defense was on the field for an extended period of time. Looks like that time that they spent on the field, especially after they turned it over on the first play in the second half and were out there for a while, starting to catch up with them perhaps.
Oh, yeah. They've that emotion and that grit. As you take a look at the Leuzinger line there coming up there, I'm going to look a little tired too.
Second down and 8. They mark it as 7 on the scoreboard. I'll go along with that. Second and 7. Here's a pitch back to Armstrong. Armstrong gets out wide right. That's what I was speaking of. They were containing that a little while ago, and you're right, Dave, perhaps, although we've still got 5:51 left, perhaps the emotional strength has evaporated for the Hawthorne Cougars.
And you notice they've got fresh, I mean, Armstrong is not one of the main three ball carriers, but he's fresh, and he's in there. He's had a couple of carries tonight. So instead of relying on Victor McClendon and Sakona and Singleton, changing it up a little bit and getting some fresh legs out there.
Cougar faithful trying to pick up this defense one more time. The band, of course, playing Conquest. The cheerleaders down on the field still showing a great deal of enthusiasm. And again, there is some time, but you got to make some stops here. McClendon coming left to right, flag on the play. Big flag on the play, and you've got an injured Cougar down on the field. That's number 31. That's Pete Naha. Naha seems to be getting up. Getting up with a bit of a limp. Do have a flag on the play as well, though.
He's going to walk off under his own power.
And of course, they lost Billy Mitchell in the first half. Pete Naha, a little bit of a limp as he'll come off. Considered probably the heart and soul of the defense, Pete Naha. This call will go against Leuzinger. It'll negate the good run by McClendon on the holding.
Well, if your sentiments are with the Hawthorne Cougars, as are most of the folks here tonight, you like this penalty. It's a good penalty. It helps you out.
Yeah, there's about 200 people on the other side whose sentiments are not with over there on the north side, closer to the 405, their sentiments are with, they would call it Lou House, I guess. This side is C House, the other side is Lou House. So, Lou House is leading, trying to keep that trophy and trying to nail down a playoff spot.
Well, it's a first down and 20. That's Armstrong with the carry. Of course, the Olympians will be content here to chew up as much clock as they possibly can, David. I think that the first down is secondary to the clock for them. The more clock they can eat, certainly one more first down will put the Olympian, put the Cougars rather, in a deep hole. So the Cougars here needing to make the stops as they've got the Olympians in a hole, second and 15.
And if there is one team that can eat up that clock, it is these Leuzinger Olympians.
Second down play. That's Kona going in motion. He handed off to number 1. Man, he's going to pick up the first down. That's Ford. Ford takes it down near the 10-yard line. No flags on the play again. That's what you spoke of earlier when you've got that double wing formation and those guys in there. Quite frankly, you sometimes don't know where the ball is until it's past you. If you're down there at field level, it's even harder, I would imagine.
And especially when you've got 8 men up in the box and all they do is get by that first wave, and they're gone to the house. With 4:10 to go, 1 week remaining in the regular season for the Leuzinger Olympians. Next week they'll be on the road at Redondo, and for the Hawthorne Cougars, they'll be playing Beverly Hills right here at home.
Okay, great. I say great, of course, the fans don't know what I'm saying, great too, but they'll find out in just a moment. We'll keep them in suspense.
Yes, Rufus was talking to our broadcast crew down in the trucks. 3:35 to go, 2 timeouts for the Hawthorne Cougars. They may have to think about taking them. Obviously, they need a stop on 2nd and 9. They have any sort of a shot.
Yeah, as you said, clock running, approaching 3 minutes. We got 3:15 to be exact. And, of course, they do need the hold here. There's a pitch back to McClendon. He's being strung out, turns it up, picks up a few yards on the play. He's going to make it a third, looks like about a third and, oh, let's call it five, maybe six. Third and six, let's say.
Well, under 3 minutes with that cup. Still in Lawndale, still with Coach Hofmann. And 2 minutes and 40 seconds away from staying there, unless Hawthorne can do something about it. This is a big third down. Of course, it's two down territory. They're not going to try a field goal attempt, I don't think.
That's number 10, Paul Sacona taking the ball. And big, big stop by the Cougar defense.
So that's to the outside, and this will bring up a fourth down. And
so the Cougars hanging around, looking for an opportunity. Now we're going to have a timeout on the field. This timeout is going to be taken by the Cougars.
And that is their second timeout.
That's the action.
With 2:09 to go.
Of course, and with that timeout, that gives us an opportunity to tell you this broadcast brought to you by Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22 in conjunction with Hawthorne Community Cable and Time Warner Communications. Production made possible by, I shouldn't say under the expert direction of Tom Strickfadden as executive producer, Channel 22 Sports. Also working in the truck with him tonight is Alejandro Espasande, Luther Mitchell Jr., Alex Torres, Steve Garcia, Deborah Savage, a sideline reporter, Jim Shelton, Mario Terrazas, along with Gihe, the beautiful one. Gihe is one of those one-name people. You know, some people reach a level of fame and sophistication that they go by one name. Now I'm being told it's Gihe Escovilla and,
Gloria,
of course,
Estefan,
Scott Gutman. And Ramdot Suchet directed. Folks, that's the crew here. Those are the folks behind the scenes that make these productions possible. We know that you and the community enjoy, and it's our pleasure to bring them to you. We're coming back to a fourth down play now.
And this is the play of the season for both of these schools right now. The 2:09.
Well, certainly for Hawthorne. There is a pitch back to McClendon. He stopped short of it. The Cougar defense rises to the challenge. They've got life left, 2:05, Dave, but they've got to negotiate over 90 yards.
And they have one timeout with which to do it. They've shown the ability, of course, to put the ball up in the air tonight. Now for these Leuzinger Olympians who play the 6-2 defense, the key is going to be that secondary. We've seen them play very good secondary play here tonight. Safety Jared Armstrong, William Martin, Lumi Murray, they're going to be tested right about now because they know that Hawthorne has to go to the air with 2:05 to go, and they need to cover a lot of territory.
Well, if you're Hawthorne, I think they've got one timeout, if I'm not mistaken. You've got one or two running opportunities, but you don't have many. Here's Barton. Looks like they're going to run the option. They try some razzle-dazzle there. It's all for naught.
And Leuzinger Olympians staying right and not fooled by anything. Got to give them credit right there. I mean, that's a tough stand.
Well,
yeah. To say Lololea hanging right in.
Minute 40 and counting left in the game. Leuzinger right now, when we show you their defensive backfield, as you can see there, even though they're relaxing, they've got three guys drop back deep. They're basically rushing only three linemen.
And
that's exactly what they're doing. They're rushing three guys. Everybody else is back in the secondary.
They're not going to let Hawthorne beat them deep if they can help it.
Well, this is their version of the prevent defense, and if I were them, and somehow or another they get the pass out of there. Now they get out of the shadow of their end zone. They're at their own 35-yard line. Losing in the prevent defense, and as a lot of coaches and announcers and fans like to say, all it does is prevent you from winning.
Well, Rufus, that an NFL-style completion right here. I mean, that is threading a needle. You usually do not see this kind of precision at the high school level. You see this in the NFL where you look at it and you say, how does a receiver just right in the right spot? And look at that. right on the hands and in a perfect location to Marcus Whittington.
Well, he found the hole in that zone defense and made the reception. Again, they're dropping back to pass, pretty decent coverage. Barton should not give up ground. Barton running around, has room to throw, lays it out there, hits another receiver on the left side. He's going down the sideline. He may go all the way. No, stopped at the 11-yard line with 56 seconds left. The Cougars are 11 yards away from getting a touchdown and the extra point to tie this game up.
Now, if we have a replay here, I'm willing to bet that the receiver comes back for the ball, which is you can't really blame Leuzinger for it. Okay, this is a good scramble.
56 seconds left. Make sure everybody
and, you know, at this point, you were saying, got to be careful about running back because you usually don't gain it. And he gets the spots the open man. I mean, there were two people out there that could have possibly gotten it. Elgin Simmons on the catch. Brian Goodall also out there. And they are threatening with 56 seconds to go.
Taken down at the by William Martin. Want to get William's name in the broadcast at the 15-yard line. Dropping back to pass. Barton with some time looking. Barton has some room to run. Should step out of bounds. But instead keeps it inbounds. 46 seconds left.
And I believe they have used their, with 46 seconds, their last time out. They come up short of the first down. It'll bring up second and about five. And as you mentioned, not going out of bounds, a key red yeah. That you got to be cognizant of where you are in the field and what the situation is.
Absolutely. There wasn't, the additional gain wasn't worth the lost timeout. Okay, fans, while we've got a timeout, let's go to a break right here on Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22. Well, it's a second down situation coming up now as we're back, fans.
And Rufus, during the break, we just thought of something interesting. Don't want to jump ahead too much. If Hawthorne scores here, they're down by one. Do they go for the automatic tie with there being no overtime, or do they go for the two-point conversion? That's interesting.
Well, first things first, they've got a second down situation they need to convert here. Of course, they're inside the 10 at the 5. Barton rolling right, has some block and lays it up. Way out of bounds, is up in the air. That's out of the back of the end zone. No.
And yeah. Whittington coming down with it out of the end zone, but the officials haven't made a call yet.
Well, now you've got a huddle there. You got the back judge talking to the referee. They're looking for an indication, and indication is incompletion.
And of course, they can't go to the replay time. They can't go to the replay booth for that one. Where if you did have that opportunity, they'd probably want to. So
Cougar fans voicing their disagreement with it. They got to get the down and distance marker straight. The marker's on the field. Well, let's watch the replay, see what happens. Okay. First of all, they're going to say that he was out of bounds. Secondly, and more importantly, what they're going to say is the first guy who touched it was out of bounds and came back in. And you can't do that.
So this is a big third down. Right here, of course, they will go for it on third and fourth. 42 seconds to go. They're still lining up. It's third and four.
Third and four.
That's the indication we have. And I think they're waiting to find out officially how much time is on the clock or something to that effect.
So momentary stoppage in play, but man, the crowd is back into it. There you see the situation. Third down, four. 38 seconds left here at Helcap Field. So that Hawthorne knocking on the door, man.
So yeah, that was a delay. They wanted 4 seconds taken off the clock. They wanted it to be 38.
And let's bear in mind, fans, this drive started at the Hawthorne 6-yard line at the 205 mark. Most folks thought it was a done deal. Hawthorne still knocking. There's Barton with the keeper. I called it. There you go, touchdown. I said there was an opportunity to run here. Barton with the keeper straight up the middle.
Let's watch the coaching staff. It looked like they said two. Here is a decision of a career. This sort of decision could make or break a coach's career. Do you go for the automatic tie with 36 seconds to go, knowing there's no overtime? Or do you risk going for the two, which gives you probably the win, but if you don't make the two, you lose?
Well, it's as they say, Dave, the axiom is real simple. On the road, you go for the tie. At home, you got to go for the win.
This is playoff, Mayor's Cup, everything. You saw that coaching staff. I think they're going for two. They're going to roll the dice.
Well, they actually
are they? Let's see.
Quite frankly, you don't have much of a choice. As I say, when you're at home in this circumstance, you got 35 seconds left. You've got to go for it. Here it comes. We're going to call it.
That's
one. You're going to have a penalty.
Right,
now, that changes complexion. This penalty is going to go against Hawthorne. I think is a pretty safe bet. Looked like the right end move.
Now it's almost going to mean they're going to have to go for it because a one-point conversion might not be that automatic 5 yards back. Because now you're looking, it would have been spotted at about the 9, which would have made it 19 yards. Now it would be about a 24-yarder and not automatic for Juan Becerra, so they have to go for it now. Look like Naha moved, and keep in mind, there's 35 seconds to go, 36 seconds to go. Even if they do make it, Leuzinger has three timeouts, and they will have to get a kickoff. But this is, do you realize some coaches are fired over these sort of decisions? We're not saying Coach Swain is going to be fired, but this is one of those sort of things that it can make or break a coaching career.
Now we've got another flag on the play.
Did they take too much time?
And you've got to delay a game. So, well, I think the decision has pretty much been crafted now. The die has been cast. It would almost seem to me that you've got to kick it and go for the tie.
And all the noise, if you can hear any noise right now from the Leuzinger fans, they are just overjoyed with the fact that now this thing, at first, it was a fairly decent bet that they might get it. Now it's going to be hard.
Well, it would have been a snap from the 3-yard line, and you go. Now they're at the 12-yard line.
And you can't blame Coach Swain necessarily. He made the decision, but his players have to execute.
Well, they're going for it. You know, I mean, this is a huge attempt. This is out of the, first of all, this isn't an ordinary two-point conversion. Barton drops back the pass. Barton looking. Barton still looking. Now he's got a person in the end zone. And they're good. Here it is. With 35 seconds left. That completion to Aaron Simmons is good. Leuzinger stunned at the moment. Trying to figure out what happened.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're not having an earthquake. The booth is shaking. This building, this field is shaking, and we're not having an earthquake. Just as noisy as it is on this side of the field, they are stunned on the Leuzinger side of the field.
Indeed, they are. That they, as we say, near you see the replay. Excellent camera work, fans, there by Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22. I think we need to get the house to let these fans know again when this game is going to be broadcast, because I got a feeling now the Hawthorne fans are going to want to watch it. For a while there, I think that it wasn't getting much coverage because they figured Hawthorne didn't want to watch the game. But if I were you, I'd let these folks know that they can see that game. This is the Hawthorne coverage right here on Hawthorne Channel 6 on those dates and times.
And Rufus, we're up here with, of course, the assistant coaches in both Leuzinger and Hawthorne. And the Hawthorne coaches are to our left. They came running out of that booth and stomping and screaming. And, of course, the Leuzinger coach on our right. Well, they've got 35 seconds to go. You take a look far off on your left. The bus driver for Leuzinger is warming up the engine, which is not good news for them. But they know they've got three timeouts, 35 seconds, and this kickoff is everything. It's a one-point game, but the kickoff is going to determine. Of course, Rufus, they can't kick field goals.
Yep. They can't kick field goals. They kick it away, but they can run the football. It's handled there. We've seen stranger things happen, and there's one of them won't happen on the play, but Leuzinger, as you said, has 29 seconds and the football and three timeouts. They've got to negotiate 68 yards.
Well, if there were 2 minutes to go, and you were a Leuzinger fan, I'd say nothing to worry about. But this Leuzinger team, we're not saying it to pick on them, but they have not shown the ability to be able to pass the ball with any sort of competency. And I use the word competency on purpose, and they do not have a kicking game to speak of. So these are one of those situations where we say every year when they get into a playoff situation, this is what can hurt them. And right now, this is a playoff situation pretty much for them. They've got to go about 69 yards without really a passing attack and without the ability to make a field goal. I mean, getting field goal range, they can win it.
Well, we've got 29 seconds left in the game. Leuzinger has the ball. Let's see what they choose to do. They're dropping back the pass. Pass over the middle. That falls woefully incomplete, you know. And that's a tough situation to put. I'm not sure. Is that Hernandez still out there, quarterback?
Yeah, Hernandez.
Yeah, it's a tough situation to put a kid in when quite frankly, that's his first pass of the game.
And, yeah, I mean, on occasion, we've seen Leuzinger throw a little passes before the end of the half just for the heck of it. But this is a situation where you've got to pass. And they still line up real tight. I mean, they may elect to go for a run just because they've got timeouts.
And they do. There's Victor McClendon there. So that's one run. They'll use another timeout. Clock now at 19 seconds. They've got maybe another whack at it with the run. You know, I mean, quite frankly, in their offense, the run is the pass, right?
Their only hope of pulling this game out is to have somebody break a long run, basically. I mean, unless you just totally fool someone, I mean, they, and we've seen Leuzinger do it before. I mean, it can be done, but your percentages drastically go down with 19 seconds to go in a ball game such as this.
Well, I'm gonna tell them when they're gonna see the game.
If Hawthorne pulls this ball game out, If they hold on to win this ball game, this is going to be one of the most dramatic games they have won, perhaps since going back to the playoff game where they beat Glendora back in 98 right here in the first round. Since then, their program has had its difficulties. And if they do win tonight, they are putting themselves in a key position to possibly nail down a playoff spot.
Well, as I said, this is for the Mayor's Cup. It's to stay alive in the playoff hunt. It's to avenge last year's defeat. There's another pass. That one's incomplete. That'll stop the clock with 15 seconds left. And it's a fourth down play.
Well, they had the right idea.
At least two. I think they'll run. I think they'll go back to their bread and butter. They've got a timeout. They'll run it here. That'll get it down to about 10 seconds, and then they'll have two cracks with the pass.
And if he hits McClendon in stride, McClendon is gone.
But you know, and we think of it as a quarterback situation. Quite frankly, to make the passing game work, there's several elements. The offensive line has to be trained and conditioned for the pass. Once again, there's what I expected to see. Sakona's running. Sakona needs to go down so they can get the timeout if he wants to keep this drive alive. And he does. 8 seconds. So now they've got maybe two plays left here, Dave. And you're right, both of them have got to be in the air. So this thing ain't over yet. As one of the greater Yankees of all time said, it ain't over till it's over. We're going to hope now that perhaps the house announcer will let these fans know, who surely are going to want to see this game again, that they can see it over the next several days on Channel 6.
Well, if Leuzinger breaks off a run here, the Hawthorne fans might not want to see it with eight seconds to go. You mentioned Yogi Berra. I'll just take a second. You know, let's congratulate. By the time this ball game is aired, we won't know what will happen, but I have to congratulate the New York Yankees and the Arizona Diamondbacks. As we tape this, the Yankees are up 3-2, but I have never, and I don't think any baseball fan has ever seen what's happened the last three nights in New York in Yankee Stadium. Unbelievable.
It has been unbelievable. It has been impressive. And now all the Yankees have to do is go through the best 1-2 punch today in baseball in terms of pitching staff. Randy Johnson on a full 4 days rest, and Curt Schilling on 4 days rest.
And by the time a lot of you see this broadcast, that ball game, the World Series could have been determined, but I tell you, it's going to be a World Series to remember.
We've shared that information with them. They aren't using it.
So this is a play to remember with 8 seconds to go.
All right. Well, if they do it well, you can get two plays out of this, but let's see if they get the first one. Drops back to pass, clock rolling. Now down to four passes up.
and needs to go down. But that's the ball game. The game ends. The game ends at the Hawthorne 14-yard line. Leuzinger runs out of time. Hawthorne with the miraculous comeback, 2:05 of the fourth quarter, Dave. They were down by 14-7. They had to go 94 yards on that last drive. They did it with a couple of big plays. Hawthorne stays alive. The Mayor's Cup comes back to Hawthorne after a two-year stay in Lawndale. And the Cougar faithful are just completely ecstatic, Dave. I can say one of the most exciting games that we've seen in the history of doing the Mayor's Cup here in the South Bay.
These Hawthorne fans, as you see, they've captured the trophy. One of the happiest nights I have ever seen at this facility here for Hawthorne as they wave the flag. The Leuzinger Olympians, they've lost a couple of ball games like this year, games that they pretty much should have had, and they scored 14 points. And from that point on, we're pretty much shut out. They were up 14-0 in the second quarter and could put nothing else on the board. And I think it says something about the style of football that they've played this year at Leuzinger. And of course, these Hawthorne Cougars, they play on emotion. And it was more than emotion tonight for the Hawthorne Cougars. It was excellent coaching and just some gutsy coaching to change things up and inspire some life in that offense, mixing up the run with the pass. The defense came to life and they earned this victory tonight, which means the Hawthorne Cougars are very much alive for a playoff spot.
There you see a shot of Mayor Larry Guidi enjoying the spoils of victory tonight. I'm sure he's going over to look for Mayor Harold Hofmann to give him a congratulatory handshake, or to accept a congratulatory handshake. There's Mayor Hofmann standing here at about midfield in the red, white, and blue jacket. Good game, though. Congratulations. And now we see Mayor Hofmann there. We're trying to get a shot for you, fans, of the two mayors and the exchange of the trophy.
Now, Rufus, you want to know what this win has done tonight for Hawthorne? Listen to this, folks out there. Okay, no matter what, Beverly Hills or Redondo. Let's say Beverly Hills and Redondo. Do we have the mayor right now? Or okay, we're looking for the mayor. No matter what, Beverly Hills and Redondo. Let's say Beverly Hills and Redondo both win. They'll go to 4-2, 4-2. Leuzinger and Hawthorne are 3-3. That means no matter what Leuzinger does next week, if Hawthorne wins the ball game, because they've beaten them head-to-head, Hawthorne is in the playoffs and Leuzinger is out. And Hawthorne can wrap up a playoff spot here next week against Beverly Hills. How about that?
There's Mayor Larry Guidi getting some FaceTime. I'm not sure. I think with the Fair Political Practices Commission, we may have to show Harold Hofmann equal amount. So now we've got them both in the camera. Our folks down on the sideline are trying to get in here and get a part of this celebration. There you see the Cougars, right?
Direct your attention to the field as the presentation for the Mayor's Cup comes out.
Cougars want that trophy, though. They just went and picked it up right away. They said, that's ours.
A lot of excitement going on down there. One of the things that we got to remember and also add to this is that the now Coach Swain in attention of his players, and there you have it. Mayor Hofmann in a demonstration of excellent sportsmanship hands over the trophy to the Cougar faithful.
Olympians walk out with your head high. Great game from both teams.
So, once again, here at Helcap Field, we've got a 15-14 final as Hawthorne comes back in the last 2 minutes of the game to seal the victory. And there you see the Hawthorne faithful players, cheerleaders, coaching staff, all enjoying this victory. Dave has certainly given you an excellent recap of what this means. And now we're trying to get Mayor James Swain on. We've got.
Oh, he hasn't been elected mayor yet.
No, I'm sorry.
A couple more games like this, he might.
No,
get
you're
elected,
right.
Might get elected mayor here in the city of Hawthorne.
You're right. A Freudian slip, if ever there were one.
I don't know what his political. He was in the Marines. I don't know what his political aspirations are quite yet, but This a lot of interesting thing. By the time this game airs and you read your papers and you know the results of some of the other games that have taken place tonight, let's just say the Hawthorne Cougars are very much alive. And right now they have taken Leuzinger out of, Leuzinger can't control their own destiny, because if these two teams wind up with an identical record, meaning if Hawthorne wins next week here against, that game was going to be meaningless had they lost. We would just be doing a meaningless game. But Hawthorne wins next week against Beverly Hills. No matter what Leuzinger does, they're in, because from beating them here tonight, they've got the tiebreaker, and Leuzinger's out.
All right, are we ready? We're getting an indication that we are ready. With the sideline interview, I believe it's Guillet. Let's go down. No, it's Deborah. Deborah's ready with an interview. Let's go to Deborah Savage right now.
Well, Mayor, tell me, how does it feel to finally have the trophy after 3 years?
Oh, it feels great tonight. I was on the sideline a little nervous, but I know my boys would pull it off. They fought like gladiators.
Now, we have one question for you. Do you have a spot already picked out for
it? Oh, yes, right in City Hall's big center cabinet. We're going to host it for a while, then we're going to bring it back to Hawthorne High so Dulcie can drool over it for a while, and maybe we'll even let Julian Lopez touch it.
All right, thank you, Mayor. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Great job.
Thank you. And here we are.
And that was Deborah Savage down on the sideline with Mayor Larry Guidi. Excellent report, Deborah. And now we're trying to get Coach Swain in here. We're down with Guillet. I'm being told she's ready. Scoreboard again shows you our final 15-14. Let's go to Guillet with Coach Jim Swain.
I'm here with Coach Swain. First of all, congratulations on bringing back the cup to from Leuzinger to Hawthorne.
Thank you, thank you. It's been away too long. You know, we owned it for a while, and it went away. It felt lonely. I know it didn't belong over there.
One quick question, I'll let you go back and celebrate. What was going through your mind in your last offensive possession?
Well, you know, it was kind of chaos. The band was playing. I heard people in my ears. You know, and I had people on the sideline in another ear, and I was just, hey, I had to settle down. I had to block a lot of it out. And then I said, hey, let's let the players who got us here make the plays. They'll take us home.
Two-point conversion, kind of gutsy.
Who wants to tie losing? And I know they wouldn't have had it any other way. Their defense played hard. They knew it was a two-point play. And I didn't even panic when the delay of game. I said that gave me more time to think and clear my head. So I'm like, hey, let it go. Let it go. I learned that from watching that De La Salle and Long Beach Poly game. Don't panic.
Congratulations on figuring out the wing team. Good luck.
Thank you.
Next week.
Okay.
Now back to Rufus and Dave.
All right. Well, there you get the comments from Coach James Swain. As he said, he wanted to put it in the hands of the players. You know, he was never deterred by the two penalties down there on the extra point conversion that backed them up 10 yards before they were able to get it away. Nonetheless, they were successful. And with that, the Mayor's Cup comes back to Hawthorne after a three-year stay over in Lawndale. So, Dave.
Well, you know, Rufus, this is, barring a playoff coverage, this is the last time this year we're going to do a Leuzinger ball game. Of course, next week we're doing Hawthorne and Beverly Hills. And being that it could be the last time that we're doing a Leuzinger ball game, the interesting thing about it is Leuzinger has got to do some soul searching. And I say that all serious. Leuzinger, they are very talented athletes. They can do many, many things. But they are so predictable, and you know, we just sit here. We don't want to beat a dead horse. They can beat you with the run, on, but we saw here tonight. Remember when had they been able to make a field goal when it was 7-0, that they win easily. If they're able to pass the ball with any sort of proficiency, they probably win. They have good athletes. They are well coached, but I think somehow that school is going to have to come up with a different philosophy. They play good defense. They're going to have to really examine themselves and say, hey, can we win at this level? Can we get into the postseason consistently? They've lost some ball games this year that they should not have lost, being that they were simply one-dimensional. Hawthorne, on the other hand, athletically, I don't think is as, not that they're bad athletes, but they're not as physical as Leuzinger. They perhaps are not as bulky and as gifted. But you know what did it for Hawthorne tonight? Up here and in here. Plain and simply. I mean, they came out with a certain game plan. It wasn't working. As we saw when they went to the pass earlier in the ball game, it was a little tough, but they stayed with it. It's heart, grit, and determination, and that's why they were able to come out here with a win. And they have put themselves in a position now where if they do win next week, they're in the postseason. Leuzinger now has taken themselves to the possibility where they should have possibly been in the playoffs, but now they're looking at elimination.
They're telling us that Deborah has the mayor of Lawndale.
And we can't
down
keep him
sideline, and that's Mayor Harold Hofmann. So let's go down to Deborah Savage with Mayor Harold Hofmann.
Mayor Hofmann, after having the trophy for 2 years, you have to give it up tonight. How do you feel about the performance your guys put on tonight?
I think both teams played tremendously. I think Lawndale played a tremendous game. I do nothing but admire Hawthorne. They didn't give up. They stayed right in there, played their hearts out, and they deserved to win the game. I think Lawndale could have won the game, but, hey, I've got kids on both sides of this field, so I've got to be honest with you. I thought that both teams played a fantastic game.
Now, do you have any pointers for the other mayor for placing the trophy back in his office?
Oh, they'll take it back to Hawthorne High School. They'll enjoy it, and I hope they do. We want them to. Larry, the mayor of Hawthorne, and myself, we'll have a lot of fun discussing this game and the winner of this trophy. But, hey, that's if we create some interest with these kids and it gives them a little bit greater desire, that's all we can ask.
Any predictions for next year?
Oh, I have to say right now we're going to take it back next year. We'll let them have it for a year. But I can only wish them the success. I know it put them in contention for the playoff, and they had to get there on with their own strength and their own energy, and we'll see what happens. I mean, it's great.
Thank you, Mayor.
You're welcome.
All right. Thank you, Deborah. And there you have Mayor Harold Hofmann. And for those of you who don't know, Mayor Hofmann has been around and been a central figure in not only Lawndale politics, but the welfare of that community for many years. A long, long time public servant. I've had the pleasure of knowing Mayor Hofmann for over 15 years. However, in the final analysis, Dave, Hawthorne comes up with an extremely improbable win. As we said, 94 yards, 2 minutes to go. They go the distance. They score the 2 points. They go for the win. As Coach Swain said, he decided it's a player's game. Let the players play for it. And they're successful. They are successful, I should say. Their season gets extended perhaps a little bit longer. Leuzinger, as you said, by the same token, has to go back and do some soul searching. So, fans, there you have it. Once again, it's an extreme pleasure for us here at Lawndale's Community Cable Channel 22 to have made this broadcast possible. Let us also thank the folks at Hawthorne Community Cable and the folks at Time Warner Communications. It's a team effort from all of us, and we do it just for you. We thank you for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you next week as the Hawthorne Cougars host right here at Helcap Field, the visiting Beverly Hills Normans, in what we are sure will be another exciting contest. Have a good evening, and we'll see you again soon.